Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, the United Nations says more than one-fourth of children under five worldwide live in severe food poverty. Dan Novak has that story. Then, Brian Lynn presents this week's Science Report. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day. But first, this report. The largest digital camera ever built for space scientists is ready to be put in place under the clear skies of northern Chile. The camera can produce images above 3.2 gigapixels in size and weighs nearly 3 tons. A pixel is the smallest area of detail in a digital image. The camera is one of the main pieces required of the Vera C. Rubin Observatory. The pieces include a telescope with a mirror that is 8.4 meters across and the huge camera. The observatory is expected to start full science operations in 2025. The observatory is on the top of a mountain called Cerro Pachón in the Coquimbo area of Chile. It is on the edge of the Atacama Desert, 565 kilometers north of Chile's capital, Santiago. Chile has many of the largest research telescopes in the southern half of the world because of the clear skies above the Atacama Desert, one of Earth's driest places. Stuart Corder is chief science officer for ORA, the Association of Universities for Research in Astronomy. He is also a director of the Noir Lab Center, which will operate the telescope. Corder said, "Everything that we needed for operations is now on the summit and ready for checkout and hopefully for installation a little bit later this year." ORA is a group of 49 U.S. institutions and 3 international ones. ORA helps operate the astronomical observatories for the National Science Foundation and the U.S. space agency, NASA. It is responsible for operating the Noir Lab Center. The camera will produce around 20 terabytes of data each night. It will take pictures of the sky for 10 years, producing a huge database of information about all parts of the sky that can be seen from Chile. Corder said one of the goals of the exploration will be to understand the nature of dark energy and dark matter in the universe. Scientists say these are forms of energy and matter that exist in theory but have not been observed. Corder said they are names we give to things because we don't really know what they are. Another goal will be to search for and study asteroids that threaten to strike the Earth, or to look for nearby stars and planets. Corder said the arrival of the camera was a really inspiring moment where you can say, "We're starting." And he added, "We're standing here at the precipice, getting ready to start a campaign that in 10 years we hope will answer the questions of when the universe was made and started into motion, and how will it continue to evolve in the future." The results may be similar to what we already know, Corder said, but they will help refine our understanding of the universe.
A recent report from the UN Children's Agency, UNICEF, says that 181 million children younger than 5 live in severe food poverty. That is more than one-fourth of the world's youngest children. The report centered on nearly 100 low- and middle-income countries. The report defines severe food poverty as eating nothing in a day, or, at best, 2 out of 8 food groups the agency recognizes. Africa's population of more than 1.3 billion people is one of the most affected, mainly due to conflict, climate crises, and rising food prices. The continent accounts for one-third of those facing hunger and 13 of the 20 most affected countries. But the report noted some progress. The percentage of children living in severe food poverty in West and Central Africa fell from 42% to 32% over the last 10 years, it said. The report noted developments including diversified crops and performance-based rewards for health workers. Without important nutrients, children living with extremely poor diets are more likely to experience wasting. Wasting is a life-threatening form of malnutrition, UNICEF said. Harriet Torless is one of the report's writers. She told the Associated Press, "When wasting becomes very severe, they are 12 times more likely to die." In several Nigerian communities, UNICEF is training thousands of women in how to increase their family's nutrient intake with cassava, sweet potato, maize, and vegetables grown in gardens at home. The agency is also helping train them in raising livestock and chickens. Several women recently gathered in a Kaltungo village to learn how to prepare those foods. Even without rain, they can be grown in sand-filled containers that require little water. Mothers in Nigeria also face the country's worst cost of living crisis. Growing food at home saves money. Aisha Aliyu is a 36-year-old mother of 5. She said her youngest child used to be skinny, but is growing fatter because of what they now grow at home. Kaltungo is a semi-arid area where climate change has limited rainfall in recent years. Some children have died of malnutrition in the past because there is little food, said Ladi Abdullahi. She helps train the women. The Sahel of the Sahara Desert is another arid area that experiences violent extremism. Malnutrition in the Sahel has reached emergency levels, said Alfred Ejem. He is a food security advisor with the Mercy Corps Aid Group in Africa. Ejem added that families have been forced to eat leaves and insects to survive because of displacement and climate change. In Nigeria's troubled northwest area, the French medical organization Doctors Without Borders said at least 850 children died last year within 24 to 48 hours of being admitted to its health facilities. Many malnourished children in the area never make it to a hospital because they live in rural areas or their families cannot pay for care. Inequality also plays a part in severe food poverty among children in Africa, the new report said. South Africa is the most unequal country in the world. And about 1 in every 4 children is affected by severe food poverty, even though it is the continent's most developed nation. Governments and partners must act urgently, Torless said. The work starts now. I'm Dan Novak. We'll be right back.
South Korea has created a new national space agency to increase its capabilities and is aiming for a future Mars landing. President Yoon Suk-yeol recently announced the establishment of the Korea Aerospace Administration, CASA. He said the country plans to spend about $70 billion on future space exploration. I have always believed that there is an infinite dream and future in outer space, Yoon said. The South Korean leader added that the agency would seek to land a homegrown probe on the moon by 2032 and plant the South Korean flag on Mars by 2045. South Korean space officials say the newly formed agency will aim to establish better cooperation than in the past, when different government ministries were involved in space activities. All space efforts are now to be developed under the CASA. South Korea became the seventh country to own an indigenous space launch rocket. Last May, that vehicle, called Nuri, successfully launched a large satellite into orbit. Additional Nuri rocket launches are planned. One is set for the second half of 2025. In the next 3 years, South Korea plans at least three more space launches. It also aims to launch several military satellites. A CASA statement said the agency is modeled after the American space agency, NASA. It said CASA would act as an aerospace control tower to oversee space policy, satellite development, and exploration missions. Planned cooperative projects include expanding South Korea's involvement in Artemis III, NASA's planned effort to put astronauts back on the moon by 2026. Research and development at CASA will be led by John Lee, who spent 30 years with NASA. Yoon said the country's space development budget would increase by $1.1 billion by 2027. That is double the current space budget. CASA will be headquartered in the city of Sochun in South Korea's far south. Yoon noted the government's plan to create the Tulus of Asia in Sachon. He was speaking about the southwestern French city of Toulouse, which developed into a European space capital because Airbus is headquartered there. CASA's planned moon landing in 2032 will be a joint project with Hanwha Aerospace, South Korea's largest defense and aerospace company. No Kyun Won is deputy administrator of CASA. He told the French news agency AFP, "Our aim is also to support the private sector in space missions as extensively as we can." One of the agency's first projects will involve a cooperation with Perigee Aerospace. The newly formed South Korean space company will aim to test a space launch vehicle from South Korea's southern Jeju Island as early as next month. International space experts say Yoon's announcement demonstrates the increasing efforts that Asian nations are putting into space programs for practical reasons. These include perfecting independent rocket technology and strengthening national pride. China has been heavily developing its space program and exploration missions in recent years. The country has successfully launched heavy-lift rockets, including the Long March 5. It has also established its Tiangong space station, sent unmanned moon probes, and launched its Shurong exploring vehicle, which reached Mars in 2021. Japan has also increased its national space activities. In January, it became the fifth nation to place a lander on the moon. Japan also plans to send an explorer or rover to Mars. And last year, India became the fourth country to land on the moon. I'm Brian Lin.
Brian Lin is here now to talk more about this week's science report. Hi, Brian. Thank you for being here.
Of course. Glad to be here.
This week, your report dealt with the establishment of a new space agency in South Korea. This seems to be the latest example of a nation expanding its space program and planning some very big exploration missions. What do you think is behind South Korea's decision to increase its space activities right now?
Yes, so what South Korea's president and space officials have said is that the country has already been expanding its space activities, actually for several years now, but the way things were organized in the past, there were several different government ministries handling different areas of the space program. So by establishing one agency, the government hopes to improve cooperation and the management of all its space policy.
And as we heard in the report, the government has set some pretty big goals, like launching a mission to Mars in the future. How realistic is this plan?
Well, as the president announced this goal, he did say a Mars mission is still years away. The country has set a date for that landing for 2045. And of course, setting these dates can be tricky because South Korea is just starting and many things can happen between now and then. Even NASA and its partners are regularly changing launch dates because of the realities of space exploration. But South Korea is making clear it is very serious about building up its space program, with the president even describing his goal to make the country a world space power.
Okay, thanks so much for being here, Brian, and thank you for that report.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
My name is Jill Robbins.
You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In Lesson 43 of the Let's Learn English series, Anna is on her way to teach a ukulele class. She realizes that she has lost something important. Let's listen.
Hey there. Tonight, I am teaching my ukulele class. It is far away, so I am going to ride the metro. Oh no, I lost my wallet. It has my metro card, my credit card, and my money. Oh no. It's times like this I remember my father's important words. He said, Anna, never. No, wait. Always have emergency money. It's empty. Time for Plan B. Extra emergency money. No, it's empty too. Anna, it's time for Plan C.
We often talk about having a Plan B for when something doesn't go as planned. Anna tells us her father said she should always have emergency money. In the video, we see her pull an envelope out of her bag, but it's empty. The same thing happened with the envelope in her boot. What do you think her plan C will be, Jill?
Anna has made some good friends, so I think she'll call one of them to ask for help. Let's find out. Listen for the way Anna asks her friend for a favor.
Hi, Marcia.
Hi, Anna. What's up?
I'm stuck downtown without any money. Would you be able to come downtown, please?
Anna, I can't. I'm too busy. I have to give a big presentation in 1 hour. Sorry.
That's okay. Good luck with your presentation.
Thanks.
Time for Plan D.
More friends may be getting phone calls, it seems. It's a little awkward, isn't it, to ask friends for money? Did you notice how Anna asked Marcia for help?
I did. She uses a modal verb, would, as she asks,
would you be able to come downtown, please?
This sentence pattern is common when we feel we might be asking someone to make a big effort to help us. When we ask, would you be able to? We are being very polite and giving the other person a chance to say no.
We could say that we are afraid we might be imposing. That's spelled I-M-P-O-S-I-N-G. Imposing on someone by making a request for something like borrowing money. To impose is to expect someone to do more than you usually ask them to do.
Another phrase we use if we feel we are imposing on someone is, would you do me a favor? Let's listen to find out how Anna asks her other friends for help. Listen for a modal verb.
Hi, Jonathan. How's it going?
Hey, Anna. Things are great. What's up?
Well, I was wondering if you could give me some money.
What?
See, I lost my wallet, and I'm stuck downtown, and I...
Anna, I wish I could. I'm at the airport with my mother. Her flight leaves in 2 hours.
That's okay. Tell your mom to have a nice trip.
I do wish I could help. Thanks.
Bye.
I'm Andrew Smith, and you're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Did you hear a modal verb, listeners? We hear Anna using another modal verb, could, when she asks Jonathan to give her some money. Like would, the modal verb could softens the request and makes it more polite.
Well, I was wondering if you could give me some money.
Jonathan uses could 2 times when he answers.
Anna, I wish I could. I'm at the airport with my mother. Her flight leaves in 2 hours.
That's okay. Tell your mom to have a nice trip.
I do wish I could help. Thanks.
Bye.
So everyone is being polite, but Anna is still stuck without any money. There's one more thing about the language we hear in this lesson. Anna says,
well, I was wondering if you could give me some money.
We use wonder in polite questions, like this. Andrew, I wonder if you're going to be busy tonight.
No, I'm not busy. Why?
Well, I have a project I need help with. I need a tall person who can reach the top shelves in my office.
Hold on a minute there, Jill. I'll be glad to do you a favor, but first, let's get back to the story. Anna has one more friend to call, Ashley.
This is serious. Time for Plan E.
Hello?
Hi, Ashley. What you doing?
Oh, hi, Anna.
Ashley, I was wondering, would you be able to come downtown and could you give me $20?
Anna, I can't.
I'll pay you back the money, I promise.
Anna, I'm not worried about the money. I'm babysitting.
Ashley is caring for a young child, or babysitting, so she can't come downtown to help. What is Anna going to do?
I remember she said she was going to her ukulele class. Maybe she can use her music to help her ask for money.
Let's listen and find out.
Well, plans A, B, C, D, and E did not work. Think, Anna, think! Time for plan F! Won't you give? Thank you very much, sir. Would you give me money? Won't you give? Oh, thank you very much. Could you give? Won't you give me money? Till next time. Won't you give me money?
Listeners, at the end of this lesson, you can hear Anna busking. That's a word we use to describe when someone performs on the street and asks the people passing by to drop some money into a hat to show their appreciation for the performance. To see her and Dr. Jill in her role as a passerby, go to learningenglish.voanews.com and watch Lesson 43 of the Let's Learn English series.
You can also find a fun board game in the lesson for practicing polite requests. Listeners, have you ever lost your wallet or something important like Anna did in this lesson? What did you do? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or in the comments on our YouTube channel. And remember that you can find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm